I would like to explain some of the concepts which we later discuss in the class. Today we have some special arrangement regarding the today's scheduled class. So, as you remember, we discuss in the class related with the job enlargement and job enrichment. I explained you with this the differences between the job enlargement and job enrichment. As I explained to you, job enlargement is basically horizontal expansion and job enrichment is basically a vertical expansion. Assigning workers with the additional same level activities, thus increasing the number of activities they perform. So in this case, we not change the cadre of the employee, we only increase the additional responsibility and the cadre remains the same. Job enrichment. In the job enrichment, we redesigning the jobs in a way that increases the opportunities for the worker to experience feelings of responsibility, achievement, growth, and recognition. Why we are using the word of the redesigning? By redesigning, we basically mean is that we talk about to enhance, we talk about the promotion of the employee. Redesign means that assistant branch manager and a branch manager. So in that case, when you enrich the job, you ultimately redesign the job as well, because you are giving them the promotions to the employee and you put them in a more responsible or in a responsible role in an organization. For instance, like in as a job as an assistant branch manager, he might be the persons might be reporting will would be or might be six or seven people. As a branch manager, assistant branch manager is also reporting to the branch manager. So including that seven people and then include the role of the assistant branch manager, so a total of eight people will be report to the branch manager. So in that case, you can say that a redesigning a job of an individual or incumbent in the organization. That is basically the example of the redesigning. Then another thing is you can also say that redesigning is basically to give you a more responsible for a job. From specialized to enlarged jobs, job rotation, moving a trainee from department to department to broaden his or her experience and identify strong and weak points to prepare the person for an enhanced role with the company. So job rotation is basically when you are training the individual employee in the organization and moving from one job to another job and you have to look out the structure and to look out the work, how individual work in a different positions, how they patiently handle the responsibility and how they perform in a different positions. Systematically moving workers from one job to another to enhance work team performance. So this is basically the one of the role where you can talk about in this relationship. De-jobbing is basically broadening the responsibilities of the company's job, encouraging employees' initiative. In that case, you talk about that you have given more responsibility to a particular individual in the organization. That the factors leading to the de-jobbing is flatter organization, work team. Organization is basically control their hierarchy and make them in a flat level that they give more responsibility to the individuals in the organization. So this is a de-jobbing basically. External factors leading to the de-jobbing is rapid product and technological change, global competition, deregulation, political instability, demographic changes, rise of a service economy. These are the case which we can contribute to the de-jobbing, or we relate it with the de-jobbing basically. Basically, when we're talking about a de-jobbing, so de-jobbing is basically you give the more responsibilities to the employees. You give them the opportunity to train themselves and not limit themselves for an any specific job. They give them a more leverage. They give them the more opportunity to an employee, and they can enhance their responsibilities, to broaden their responsibility. That would be the reason of the deregulation. That would be the reason of global competition, that more skills are required. Nowadays, AI is one of the threatening factor for employee who are working in a particular place or in a particular industry. You can say that. Then the other thing is that the competency-based job analysis is basically competencies demonstrable characteristics of a person that enable performance of a job. Competency-based, as the name indicate, is talk about the compet how much you are competent for a job. Describing a job in terms of the measurable, observable, behavioral competencies, knowledge, skills, or behaviors an employee must exhibit to do a job well. So competency is that how much you are competent, how much you have the ability, how much you have the focused on a job, how much you can relate your job, how much you are able to work in the organization. So these are the basically concepts which are related with the competency-based job analysis. If you have any questions, you can ask from me through the WhatsApp, as we will not discuss this chapter in our next class, because I will discuss the another chapter later with the personnel needs and analysis. So today I'm going to conclude this chapter. Then the other thing is to why use competency analysis to support high performance work system. As earlier in the first chapter, we discussed about high performance work system. Traditional job descriptions with their list of specific duties may actually backfire if a high performance work system is the goal. We need the more competent people. We need more good people in the organization. We know we need more skillful people. If your traditional job descriptions with a list of specific duties, so that may actually backfire if you have the goal is to high performance work system. So high performance work system is the kind of a system where only those people will survive who has the skills, who has the competency, or who can enhance their competencies. You can say that. Otherwise, all those people who do not have competencies or who are not focused on their skills, improving their skills, they will ultimately face problems. Maintain a strategic focus, describing the job in terms of the skills, knowledge, and competencies the worker needs is more strategic. Measuring performance, measurable skills, knowledge, and competencies are the heart of any company's performance management process. Here we talk about standards, here we talk about performance. Measurable skills is that you give them a proper, you can say that required skills, how you measure the skills, or you can say that you have set some measurable skills for an employee, and based on that skills, knowledge, and competencies, companies can perform. If you do not have a good members, if you do not have a good knowledgeable people in the organizations, so for a longer run, your organization cannot survive. So nowadays, as in 21st century and this turbulent environment and this in the era of this AI, you need more good people in the organization. You want them to work with you and achieve your organizational goals in a more better way. Other thing is the performance management. Performance management is managing all elements of the organizational process that affect how well employees perform. Types of competencies: general competencies, reading, writing, and mathematical reasoning. Leadership competencies, leadership and the strategic thinking and teaching others. Technical competencies, specific technical competencies required for a specific types of jobs or occupation. Technical competencies are obviously vary from one industries to another industry. For airline industry, you need to be understand that how you work with the passengers, how you lead your aircraft, how you work with the airline industries, these kind of things. And then when you're teaching side, and when the other technical part, engineering and other architectural part, you have to require a different technical skills and different others measurements to through which we can in judge the or gauge the performance of the employees. Leadership is another domain, and then you have a general competency, understanding, reading, writing, mathematical reasoning. These are also the components for the better employees. So it's vary from one organization to another organization. In some of the case where you need a leader, good leadership skills. In some of the area where you're not focused on the leadership skills, you're more focused on a technical skills or you required for a technical competencies in the organization. So it's vary from one industries to another industry. Thus, this is a background data, for examples, of a job title, customer service clerk. You have given then the job summary and then the example of one duty, one job duty, and just read this. And when if you have questions, so I will discuss with you as well. Then the other thing is the OST or NET online, find the occupation, skill search, crosswalk, the requirements of the jobs. These are the skills. These are the jobs basically, and then the required skills and the others, OST or titles. First line supervisors, managers of a retail sales workers, and then the others requirements, other areas is also available. You can search the OST or NET online, and then you find out the occupations and the skill set required and the crosswalk also. If you have any questions, you can discuss with me, and then we will also talk about the other things as well. The HR scorecard is also another tool to judge your employees in the organization, you to find out their role, how they work in the organization, how they perform their duties. These are the basically the skills which we required for the in the scorecard. In the scorecard, you mostly focus on that how people work for a particular job and how they perform their jobs and how they handle their work. These are the basically requirements when you're talking about the HR scorecard. These are some of the summary which we discuss in this chapter. We have interaction on these things in the class, and largely we covered all part of these discussions here in this chapter. So this is a very important chapter as far as your examination point of view concerned. So please go through with this chapter. What we have discussed in this chapter, you have to recall it. And if you have any questions, so before discussing the next chapter in the class, we will go through and I will give you a positive response. And in this, you also have I have also given you an assignment. And based on that assignment, I will mark your attendance for the today's class. Today's we miss our class due to some political unrest here in the city. So we not able to take the class. So that the end of this semester, the end of this subject, sorry, the end of this chapter. And if you have any questions, so I will reply you, and I will discuss with you as well. But go through with this chapter, this discussions which we have, and we covered a lot of very important topics. I have give you another glance on this chapter, so you have to see it. This we discuss very useful information that what is a job analysis is. Then we talk about job description, then we talk about job specifications. I explained to you that job description is basically related with the job duties, responsibilities, reporting relationships, working conditions, supervisory relationships, and then we job specification is basically a job's human requirements, that is a requisite acquisition skills, requisite education, sorry, skills, personality, and all those important elements. Then the work activities, human behaviors, machines, tools, work aids, and then the performance standards, job context, human requirements. Other things, the EEO compliance, recruitment selection, compensation, performance appraisal training, discovering unassigned duties. This is also we discussed in the uses of the job analysis information. Then we also discussed about the steps in the job analysis. as far as the examination point of view concerned, this is a very important thing. The decide how you will use the information, review relevant background information. I also give you a class task where you need to judge any of the title or any of the job. And then based on that job, you need to set some parameters, you need to set some standards for that job and how you evaluate that job. So that was the process which you already have gone through in the class. So actually analyze the job, verify the job analysis information, develop a job description and job specification in the end. We also discuss about charting the organization, organizational chart, a chart that shows the organization-wide distribution of work with titles of each position and interconnecting lines that show who reports to and communicates to whom, process chart, a workflow chart that shows the flow of inputs to outputs and outputs from a particular job. We discussed about these things in the process chart. And this is also, we talk about the plant manager. This leads to the quality control clerk, and then you have to plant manager, component quality, and then the product quality output to the plant manager. These are some of the flow we of the jobs flow, basically, jobs workflow. Then we also discuss the methods of collecting job analysis. This is also very important. Interview. Through interview, we can also collect some information for the job analysis. Then we also have some guidelines for the interview. We have a quickly established rapport with the interviewee. Follow a structured guide or checklist, one that lists open-ended questions and provides space for the answers. So this is the different techniques and different procedures for collecting information. For the job analysis, the questionnaires is also another approach. You have a structured checklist, you have an open-ended questions. Another part of the things, you are very much familiar with the advantages and disadvantages. Observation is another method. Participant diary logs is another method. We have gone through with the position analysis questionnaire, Department of Labor, DOL procedures. Functional job analysis techniques. These are some of the very important techniques. These are some of the job analysis schedule, job description, then what kind of the things were we covered in the job descriptions. These are the things we discuss. And these are standard occupational classification we also discuss in the class in a very detailed. And then job identification, job summary, exempt and non-exempt. Status the section part of the employee. If you have any questions related with the exempt or non-exempt, you can ask. In fact, you can go through with the exempt and non-exempt job titles or what is basically the status of the job related with the exempted and non-exempted. What do you mean by this? You need to search it. I will ask from you in the next class as well. Then the change of command is very important and very key factor in the organization. responsibility, standard classification, occupation. This is the example of the standard occupational classification, personnel care and service occupations. The other part of the discussion, standard performance and working conditions, job specifications, we discussed trained personnel, untrained personnel, based on judgment, based on statistical analysis. So these are the very important things which we discussed. This is also another thing, writing job descriptions. I told you in the class that this is also another important part. Job analysis is another thing, and the job description steps are different totally. So this concludes the chapter. And if you have any questions, so I'm here. And I will answer you, and we will discuss the in very details in the class as well. And you can also ask through WhatsApp as well. Thank you very much. Goodbye.